creating and distributing relevant and valuable material in order to attract and retain a targeted audience online, that is content marketing. We use it to get leads, to increase sales, to increase brand awareness, to engage our audience. But are we too traditional when we do content marketing? Should we experiment more? Yes, at least with some of the content, according to our next speaker, Ross Simmonds, global speaker and digital marketing strategist. Welcome, Ross Simmonds.
Now this is a story all about how my life got flipped, turned upside down, and I'd like to take a minute, just sit right there. I'll tell you how I became the prince of a town called Bel Air.
What's up, Stockholm? I love that song so much. Experiments. Experiments have given us some of the greatest inventions of our time. Experiments have offered us cures to diseases. Experiments have allowed us to learn things about our world that we never would have imagined. Experiments have given us great things like pumpkin spice lattes and Velcro. Experiments have truly changed the world. I've been doing experiments for a very long time, and throughout all of my experimentation, I always go back to a very simple model. Build, ship, learn, decide. Now, I know what some of you are thinking. I've been listening to these talks, and some of you might be a little bit scientific. You might be all into the chemistry and the formulas and stuff like that, and you might be thinking, bro, do you even science? Like, that's pretty bare bones. That's pretty basic. That's not real science. Like, you can't just say that that's what an experiment is. And I understand that. I get that. I get what you're saying. But I intentionally use a model, build, ship, learn, decide, that is very simplistic intentionally. You see, by embracing this model that is very lean, very agile, something that is very straightforward, it allows me to come up with ideas quickly, but kill them even quicker. It allows me to experiment without fear. So I can embrace this idea of experimentation with my own brands, but also experimentation with my clients in some of the most boring and some of the most interesting industries. I've been doing experiments for a very long time. I've been experimenting before I knew what SEO was, before I knew what AdWords was, and I'm sure you've probably been experimenting as well. Let me take you back into time when I did one of my very first experiments. It was the year 1994. When I looked like this kid up here with an MC Hammer haircut. I used to wear dinosaur sweaters and run around dancing to Fresh Prince. But it was 1994, and I always had this curiosity about me. And there's one thing in particular that always blew my mind. I have some sympathy for people who live here in Sweden because, similar to you, I have a lot of snow back home. So back home, we used to get tons and tons of snow. And when the snow would come, I would always ask myself, what happens to the worms? So I had to find out what was going on with these worms. The snow would come, the worms were there. Every spring, the worms are still there. I was like, what's going on? How are the worms still here in the snow? Like, why aren't they frozen? So I had an experiment. Build, ship, learn, decide. My goal was to find out if worms survived in the cold. My build was to take an ice tray, add a little bit of water, take some worms, and then ship it. How did I ship it? I took that ice tray and I put it in the freezer. So, my wife, my family, my friends, they will all tell you that I have a horrible memory. So I forgot all about these worms. They're sitting there in the freezer. I'm living life, playing with gargoyles and a bunch of toys. I remember it like it was yesterday. I was sitting downstairs with my dad. We were watching WWF wrestling, back when it was called WWF. And we were watching TV, and I hear this scream from the kitchen. Ross Jarrell Simmonds, get up here. It was my mom. She found the worms. And in that moment, I learned two things. One, I learned that those worms died. And two, that I would never do that again. So that was also a decision because Mama Simmonds wasn't too pleased. As an FYI, that's not my mom. Just in case you weren't sure, that's not actually her. But I decided in this moment, right? I decided in this moment that I wouldn't be able to do this again. And I also realized that worms do die in the cold. If you actually are trying to figure it out in your head, well, happens, find me after. I'll explain the entire thing around how they actually survive. So there's this common myth in business and marketing and communications that experimentation doesn't work when you're a small or you're a medium brand, that experimentation has to be expensive. It doesn't. Experimentation and content marketing does not have to be extremely expensive. You just have to understand the process. You have to embrace data. You have to embrace the actual philosophy that I've talked about today. And my hope is, throughout this presentation, throughout today's talk, I'll be able to share with you a few things. I want to share with you some tactical advice around experiments that I've run with myself, with some of my own brands, but also with some clients that you can use in your own organizations for the brands that you work with, the brands that you represent, the companies that you own, and then take that to actually drive real results. Because the reality is, experiments do work. Regardless of your size of your company, regardless of your budget, regardless of how much time and experiments you've actually embraced over the last few years, experiments can work. You just have to do them right. And don't get me wrong, I realize that I'm this huge advocate for experimentation, and some people aren't necessarily going to do some of the crazy things that we're going to talk about today. And I will be the first to admit that yes, some experiments will fail. You're not always going to succeed. I don't know if you guys had this, but a few years back, Heinz rolled out this ketchup, which was purple and green and orange, and it was a huge million-dollar failure. They had invested so much money into sending out this ketchup with all these different colors of the rainbow, and all the kids liked it, but the parents were like, ugh, that's gross. Ain't nobody got time for that. We don't want purple ketchup on our fries. It's not something that we're up for. So it failed. It was an experiment that failed. Another low-cost experiment, my first approach on Medium. I took a post, I republished it on medium.com. Press share, I got 2 likes. One of them was from my mom. It was not a success, right? So, but by embracing build, ship, learn, decide, I've been able to learn about this channel and I've been able to understand how to do it well. When you embrace that philosophy, you have an opportunity to embrace experiments that soar. You have an opportunity to create content experiments that truly work. On SlideShare, for example, I've been able to reach millions of people through my content. Or if you take this example from McDonald's, where they did Our Food, Your Questions, where they opened up a platform and they said to the world, ask us anything about our food, and we will answer you transparently and with authenticity to really tell you what's actually going on in those Chicken McNuggets. That's experiments that work. They generated thousands of dollars worth of press, and it was an extreme success. And that's what happens when you're willing to experiment. And when I talk about experimentation, I'm not just talking about experimenting with buttons and colors. A lot of people think that experimentation is just like, let's change the subject line. Oh, look, we're innovative. We're experimenting because we changed the subject line. That's not enough. You have to experiment with things that go a little bit deeper. And throughout this presentation, I'm going to talk about how you can experiment with things like your actual approach. I'm going to talk about how you can experiment with different channels. And I'm going to talk about experimenting with the actual story that you're telling your audience. Sure, experimentation will make you feel a little bit uncomfortable. At times when you're doing this, you will feel a little uncomfortable and a little uneasy around the idea of doing something that potentially will fail. If everything succeeds, you're probably not doing enough that's risky. So yes, you have to embrace the chaos. And that's where the magic happens. Because the magic happens when, okay, before I say embrace the chaos, I don't mean running around like you just saw a rare Pokemon outside, everybody's like crazy, oh, where is it, what do we do next? No, you have to have some structure around the chaos, which is why I believe build, ship, learn, decide is the right philosophy and the right model to take. You are going to fail. I can remember one of my very first failures as it came to content marketing experiments. It was a website called Reddit, and I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with Reddit. What Reddit is, it's essentially a community where a bunch of people have conversations in a variety of different communities about different topics. You upload links, people talk about them, so on and so forth. I wanted to crack the code on Reddit because in marketers, everybody tends to get the heebie-jeebies when you talk about, oh, we're gonna do marketing on Reddit. Oh, let's use Reddit as a marketing channel. It's kind of a big no-no, you don't do that. So I was like, all right, let me take a shot at Reddit. I had a bunch of content that I created over the years, and I took it, and I was gonna submit it to a subreddit called Our Technology, a community where everybody talks about technology. So I took all of my blog posts, and I just started submitting links. I'm publishing these links out. I'm like, this is gonna be great. They're gonna love it. This content's gonna go viral. I'm gonna kill it. I'm gonna be famous. This is awesome. What happened? You're banned. Ross, you're blocked. I was done. Bye, Felicia. You're out of here. And I was like, okay, this sucks, right? Like, this sucks. This is brutal. I'm blocked on Reddit, the one channel that I was actually trying to do. What did I do? I could have threw my hat in the ring. I could have walked away and I could have said, okay, that's it. I'm done. I failed on Reddit. What's next? But instead, I went back to that philosophy. Build, ship, learn, decide. I decided that it was time for me to actually learn what people wanted on Reddit versus what I thought they wanted on Reddit. So I decided I was going to study what marketers were doing. And I quickly realized that there was a huge gap between what Reddit wanted and what marketers were trying to get you, were trying to offer people on Reddit. One of the key insights came from this one post. This company uploads this meme, and in the first comment, you can see what it says. It says, this sucks, this post sucks, the OP sucks, the pen sucks, everything about this sucks. If Reddit will do one thing, it will tell you when your content sucks. They will tell you where to go and how to get there real quick. And that's what happened in this example. It's an example that demonstrates what a lot of marketers make the mistake of assuming when they go into this channel. They think you just have to submit a bunch of jokes, you have to submit a bunch of links, and your content will go viral, and then you'll win. It doesn't work that way. So I decided again, go back to that model, build, ship, learn, decide. What else can I learn? I decided that I would go to the various subreddits, the different communities on Reddit, and then sort the content by the top posts and see what people actually wanted. And by doing that, I was able to analyze and identify trends that were happening in different communities, and I started to clue into something. Different communities want different types of content. If you go into a subreddit that's all about barbecue food, they want recipes. They want content that's showing you how to create a great roast. That's the type of content they wanted. If you go into a subreddit like Our Entrepreneur, they want in-depth articles where you're showing how-to resources, where you're giving them a look behind the scenes into what happened, how you built your business. And they want to see metrics. They want to see the guts of your content. And if you go to a subreddit like Our Canada, where we're actually just trying to figure out what we're going to do when all the Americans move up because they're going crazy down there, that's a whole different topic. I love you, just joking. I know this is going to be on YouTube, so Americans, I love you. Don't take my passport. But when you look at it and you realize that all of the different communities are different, you start to clue in, okay, Reddit is just like other content platforms. It's just like Medium, it's just like LinkedIn Pulse. The only difference is you have to understand the voice and the way that they consume content. So you have to understand the way that they're sharing content online. You have to understand the way that they're telling stories and the way that those stories get distributed. And once you do that, you can start building content worth reading. Now, I took a handful of the resources and blog posts that I already knew were successful, content that I knew people wanted in the entrepreneurship community, that I knew people wanted in the business community, and then I repurposed it with a story that I knew Reddit would be interested in. So I used the Reddit functionality. I used websites like Imgur for my images, and I told a story that Reddit would resonate with. Since then, I've been able to have significant success on Reddit. I believe I cracked the Reddit code, so to speak. I've been on the front page multiple times. I've been able to help clients generate thousands and thousands of views, close multiple clients worth over $10,000, $20,000. I've been able to drive meaningful results through this channel. But not all experiments are successful. This one worked. This was a great success. But one of my first experiments, one of my first channels that I embraced was a website called Quora. And Quora is a question and answer website that is one of the highest ranked domain authority websites online. So I was like, okay, Quora is a juggernaut. I need to embrace this channel. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to go into this website where people are asking questions about business, where people are asking questions about Facebook marketing, where people are asking questions about social media, and I'm going to answer every question I can. And I'm going to add as much value as I can. And I'm going to drive so much traffic to my site that I'm going to win on Quora. What happened? Not much traffic, that's for sure. During my peak, I didn't even hit 20 visits from Quora as it relates to referral traffic. Not even 20. And I was spending a lot of time answering these questions over and over and over again, late at night, coffee, writing answers. No traffic was coming back to my site. But then I found something. I started to realize that Quora had an interesting relationship with a handful of media sites. So I wrote an answer to a question that I thought, okay, the media might be interested in this. So I wrote an answer to a question about what are the business lessons that you could learn from Jay-Z? So I answered this question. They then took it, they took that same answer, and they republished it on Forbes.com. I realized that they have relationships with Huffington Post, MSN, Mashable, a handful of big websites. So I said, okay, this is interesting. If my clients need to get some press, maybe I can take a pop culture reference, something that's topical, add it to the answer on Quora, and then the media companies will start to feature it. And they did it time and time and time again. From Yahoo to Huffington Post, content directly from Quora has been then featured for media sites over and over again. This was the win. This was the only win, because I was able to quickly realize when it came to Quora, if I was trying to drive traffic, I had to say, baby, bye, bye, bye. But when it came to actually generating media attention, I could win using this platform. Most recently, for probably the last year and a half, I've been experimenting with Instagram marketing. And Instagram is one of those channels that I've truly grown to love and hate at the same time. We started with Instagram marketing for my company, Hustle and Grind. And Hustle and Grind targets entrepreneurs, freelancers, businesses. We sell posters, we sell coffee. We sell a handful of products that entrepreneurs would want. And we had this insight, and we saw that a bunch of entrepreneurs and people who were freelancers and things like that were following inspirational accounts on Instagram. But all of the accounts looked the same. It would be a Leonardo DiCaprio picture, black and white, and then they put some text over it, and they'd tell you to seize the day, and everybody was going crazy. Double tap. They loved it. I was like, okay, that's cool. That's interesting, but let's take a different spin. So what we did was we invested time in creating a batch of content that was custom illustrated. So we decided that we were going to invest in some high-quality design. In 6 months, we were able to grow the account to over 50,000 followers. Good win. That was success. So build, ship, learn, decide. We learned that quality content that differentiates you from other companies is a success. Knew that already, but it worked. Then something interesting happened. One of our posts got reposted by an account called 9gag, and they mentioned us when they shared it. Now, 9gag had 2.3 million followers at the time. And when they put up this post and they added the at symbol, at Hustle and Grind, our followers on Instagram was going up by thousands every single minute. So something clicked. It was like, okay, if we get bigger accounts to talk about our account and they're mentioning us, it means that we can grow for free without spending money. This is crazy. So what did we do? We embraced the world of influencers, the world of getting shout outs from accounts with bigger accounts than ours. So we found 7 different accounts, all on Instagram, that had a similar audience that wanted to connect with entrepreneurs. We created a WhatsApp group, and we told everybody that on Monday, you would be giving a shout out on your account to this account. On Tuesday, you'd give it to this account. Wednesday, to this account, so on and so forth. So every day for an entire week, we were giving each other shout outs. Our account cracked 100,000 in 2 months. It was insane. Every single week, we're growing by thousands and thousands of followers. And then I've been able to replicate this same approach with influencers, with different industries, with boring industries, for clients, as well as for my own company. Now, here's what's interesting. Instagram was my girl. I loved Instagram. I loved it. It was great. And then most recently, they changed their algorithm, and everything started to tank. You can experiment all you want, but when these channels start to change their algorithm, you can see your conversions drop, you can see your engagement drop, you can see a significant drop in your revenue, in your sales. Things tend to change. And that's what we faced. We faced recently that Instagram's engagement has just fallen off completely. But I go back to that model. Build, ship, learn, decide. Most recently, we've started to invest time and energy in learning about Instagram Stories, their video platform. And we're generating about 5,000 views per video that we post on Instagram Stories. And we're recognizing most recently that if we include call to actions in those stories, people are actually driving back to the link in our bio, because on Instagram, you can't share a link. And they're actually downloading resources, generating leads, buying product, and we're having some success there. This is something that I'm going to continue to experiment with. I'll definitely be writing about it on my blog. But this is where I'm investing my next experiment to figure out how to make this thing work. I'll take you back to another experiment, SlideShare. So when I first jumped on SlideShare, it was a channel that was essentially used for uploading your decks. You would give a presentation, you'd upload your deck, you'd tell people to go check it out, call it a day. I decided, okay, let's take a shot at this. So it was after Obama's second term, and I created this presentation called How Did Obama Do It? Exactly. Through content excellence. So I put up this presentation, talks about how Obama embraced content excellence, and I looked at three things that I've talked about throughout this entire presentation. I looked at the channel itself, which was SlideShare. It wasn't something that was validated at this point. I looked at the approach that I was taking. I was just uploading a blog, a SlideShare deck that essentially told a story around how you can replicate Obama's success for your own brand. And then I was investing time and energy in telling a story about a topic that I knew people were familiar with. So across the board, some of these things were validated, some of them were not. When I put up this deck, I got 7,000 views. I thought, okay, not bad. That's interesting. But what would happen if I took a different approach? While everybody else is using SlideShare to simply share facts and stats, what if I took an approach where I invested in design and I also told a story directly through the slides instead of just sharing one-off slides about stats and experiments and examples of the work that he was doing? What would happen if I treated a SlideShare deck more like a video or more like a blog post than just a deck? What would happen? Could I double it, triple it? Well, the results started to speak for themselves. I was able to generate more than 500,000 views on some decks, 100,000 views on others, and SlideShare essentially went from a channel that was unknown to a channel that I knew I could make work time and time and time again. These decks have been shared by thousands of people. They've reached millions of people. And it's, again, because of the fact that I embraced build, ship, learn, decide. Now, some of you might be thinking, okay, Ross, that's cool. You got a handful of views. I can't pay my bills with views. I can't pay my mortgage with views. That's not enough. And I hear you. I get that. I'm a big fan of Wu-Tang, and Wu-Tang always says, cash rules everything around me. And there's this philosophy when it comes to SlideShare that you can't actually generate revenue. I disagree. With SlideShare, I believe it's one of the most underrated channels in B2B marketing. I decided build, ship, learn, decide, that I would start testing call to actions at the end of these SlideShare presentations that went one of two ways. I would use the native call to actions, which generated the results you see here, where people are actually submitting their information for me to work with them on their projects, work with some of my clients on projects, and the leads actually converted to thousands and thousands of dollars worth of work. Some of this has also been from experimenting with the call to actions that happen in the actual design of the slides. And what I found is that if you use three slides leading up to a lead form telling people to do something, they actually do it. Now, that's the value of experimentation. But I realize that not all experiments are going to be the same. I recognize that not all organizations are going to be the same. For you, you have to start by looking at budget, you have to look at your time, you have to look at the resources available to you to actually invest time and energy in doing experiments. Once you determine that your organization is built to embrace experimentation, it's time to do three things. One, you have to determine, is this a risky experiment? Is this a low-risk experiment? Or is this a high-risk experiment? And the way that you determine that is by asking yourself, is this channel something that has been validated? So for example, Instagram as a channel is something that I validated. I knew that experimenting on Instagram would work. Then you have to ask yourself about the approach. So when I took a storytelling approach to SlideShare, that was something different. That was a unique approach that hadn't been done before. So that's what I'm experimenting with. Then you have to experiment with the topic. So when I go into Reddit and I'm creating these long-form blog posts, types of content that nobody has created before on this channel, that's me experimenting with the topic. What you want to do is ask yourself, have we validated all three of these things? If you have, that's a low-risk content experiment. If you haven't validated any of them, that is a high-risk content experiment. Ladies and gentlemen, at the end of the day, experimentation has the opportunity to drive real results. meaningful results that can impact your bottom line. And I believe this because of a model and a philosophy that I truly hope that all of you can take and actually implement in your own organization. And it's a model that is called the 70-20-10 model, a model that was created by Coca-Cola around experimenting with content and content storytelling. It's the idea that 70% of all the content you create should be low-risk content. That's the blog post, those are the tweets, those are the simple Facebook updates, that's the SEO-driven content that lives on your landing page. 70% of your content should be low risk. 20% should have maybe one or two of those things validated that I talked about, maybe the approach, maybe the topic. 10% should have nothing validated at all, and it's you trying to push your organization and your company forward. And when you do this, when you embrace this model, it gives you a chance to have a competitive advantage. How? Because when you're doing that 10%, that innovative content, and you're experimenting, build, ship, learn, decide, you're gonna start validating different things that are going to make that high-risk content innovative. And that innovative content is going to start getting things validated that will turn it into low-risk. And if you can do that before your competition, you'll be investing in channels that are generating leads, driving sales, that your competition is hesitating to jump into. So I push you to try experiments as it relates to the channels, as it relates to the topics, as it relates to the approach. Experiment with everything around you. Embrace the chaos. Because that's what pushing this industry forward is all about. That's what life is all about. The more we tinker, the more we play, the more we experiment and push our industry forward, the better we'll be able to serve our clients, the better we'll be able to serve each other. And sure, don't get me wrong, you can sit on the sidelines and you can wait. You can hope that you'll go to a presentation and somebody will tell you what you should do. But in that case, you may as well be as dead as a worm in my mom's freezer. Thank you guys for listening.
Thank you so much,
Thank
Ross.
Thank you.
Like you said, when you experiment, you could fail.
Yeah.
And we are quite afraid of failure, aren't we?
We are.
Why do you think that is?
Nobody likes to fail. Like when I failed going into Reddit for the first time, I essentially curled up into a ball and wanted to cry. Nobody likes to fail. It doesn't feel good. But we have to push ourselves to embrace failure if we want to grow. The only time in which you can go to that next level is when you're pushing yourself to a point of failure. It's kind of like a video game. You're going to fail over and over again, but eventually you'll learn how to beat the big boss. And when you do, you go to the next level, which is what you should always be aspiring to do in your career, but also in content marketing.
So content marketing as a video game.
Exactly.
Yeah.
100%.
Yeah. Let's check with the editorial department to see if there are any questions from the audience.
Yeah, we have one. We were wondering here, if you are an employee at a company and you do an experiment and everything just goes horribly, horribly wrong.
Right.
What should you do, or what should the organization do? What happens?
For sure. So as long as it didn't cost billions of dollars, then you're going to actually talk about your lessons. Talk about what you learned from that experiment so you can show the team and the organization, like, look, we did this, it didn't work, but look at what we learned so we can do better next time. And by doing so, you demonstrate to your manager, you demonstrate to the organization, okay, this person's not only trying new things and is pushing us to innovate, but they're also reactive enough to realize that they failed, they can learn something from it, and then take that to the next one.
Yeah, so use the failure in your...
Exactly, use the failure to kind of help you move forward.
Yeah.
Otherwise, like, that's the purpose of experiments. It's to fail fast, learn a few things, and then continue moving forward after that.
You told us about the Reddit experiment. Is that your, you know, most risky one, or have you done any other experiments?
I'd say it was the most risky because the entire marketing community is kind of still afraid of Reddit.
Yeah.
So for me, it was a big push. I tweeted out, I'm going to try to crack Reddit, said I was going to do this thing, and if I failed, it would have been pretty loud. But I was able to do it, and it worked out. But I'd say that was one of the risky, and it's still the hardest to sell to clients. Everybody's afraid of Reddit at the end of the day. So it's a channel, as a big Reddit fan and a user, I understand why brands are kind of hesitant to jump into the channel, but it's definitely still a risky channel that I think a lot of organizations can capitalize on if they get over that hump of...
Yeah, you think that we should try it.
Exactly, try it.
Could all business companies try Reddit?
I think so. Like I said, I've worked with some very boring and unique companies that have been able to drive results through Reddit, and you wouldn't think at first that they could do it. But if you go at it from a certain approach and a certain angle, you can find some interesting insights that lead to amazing opportunities.
Okay. Great. Thank you, Ross.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Pleasure.